On the basis of the testimony and the evidence before the House, President Trump has committed impeachable high crimes and misdemeanors by corruptly abusing the office of the presidency.
What has happened in the case today is something that I do not think we have ever seen before. A president who has doubled down on violating his oath to faithfully execute the laws and to protect and defend the Constitution.
I'm concerned about lowering impeachment standards to fit a paucity of evidence and an abundance of anger. I believe this impeachment not only fails to satisfy the standard of past impeachments, but would create a dangerous precedent for future impeachments.
If what we're talking about is not impeachable, then nothing is impeachable. This is precisely the misconduct that the framers created a constitution, including impeachment, to protect against.
If the president uses his office for personal gain, the only recourse available under the Constitution is for him to be impeached, because the president cannot be, as a practical matter, charged criminally while he is in office, because the Department of Justice works for the president. So the only mechanism available for a president who tries to distort the electoral process for personal gain is to impeach him. That is why we have impeachment.
The Constitution of the United States does not care whether the next president of the United States is Donald J. Trump or any one of the Democrats or anybody running on a third party. The Constitution is indifferent to that. What the Constitution cares about is that we have free elections.
The Constitution, the supreme law of the land, specifies bribery as a ground of impeachment as it specifies other high crimes and misdemeanors. Bribery had a clear meaning. If the House believes that the president solicited something of value in the form of investigations or an announcement of investigations, and that he did so corruptly for personal gain, then that would constitute bribery under the meaning of the Constitution. And it would not be lawless. It would be bribery under the law.
This statement has been made, not just by these witnesses, but Chairman Schiff and others, that this is a clear case of bribery. It's not. And if you can't make out those crimes, then don't call it that crime. If it doesn't matter, then what's the point? Call it treason. Call it endangered species violations, if none of this matters.
If Washington were here today, if he were joined by Madison and Hamilton and other framers, what do you believe they would say if presented with the evidence before us about President Trump's conduct?
I believe the framers would identify President Trump's conduct as exactly the kind of abuse of office, high crime and misdemeanor that they were worried about, and they would want the House of Representatives to take appropriate action and to impeach.
But impeachments require a certain period of saturation and maturation. That is, the public has to catch up. I'm not prejudging what your record would show, but if you rush this impeachment, you're going to leave half the country behind.
Corea del Norte acusó recibo de la amenaza velada de Donald Trump y dijo que respondería con las acciones correspondientes si Estados Unidos los ataca militarmente. Según la agencia oficial de noticias, el jefe del Estado Mayor del Ejército del Pueblo dijo que una operación en contra de Corea del Norte sería horrible para Estados Unidos. Durante la reunión de la OTAN el martes, Donald Trump dejó entrever que desplegaría toda su artillería en contra del país asiático si era necesario. Y para remontar la intensidad en el intercambio de amenazas, un oficial de alto rango de Pyongyang, pues dijo que enviarían, y cito, un regalo de Navidad a Estados Unidos, aunque no especificó a qué se refería. Sí comentó que dependería del curso de acción que tomara el gobierno del país norteamericano. Los expertos no descartan que se trate del reinicio de las pruebas de misiles de largo alcance.
The phone records, again, that were revealed in today are also show an apparently obscured dash one phone number that Giuliani called. The New York Times is now reporting that you're investigating if that number is the president himself. Can you confirm that?
Well, we can't confirm yet who that dash one number belongs to, but certainly there was indications in the trial of Roger Stone that when he was communicating with the president, it would show up in phone records as a dash one number. But here you have Rudy Giuliani in communication with the Office of Management and Budget, in communication with the White House, and you also have presidential conduct in the form of tweets and other actions around the timing of different communications. And so We still have a lot of work to do in terms of identifying precisely who Giuliani was talking with and about what at what times of this chronology. But even in the absence of that, the evidence is overwhelming that the president was using Giuliani to coerce Ukraine into these investigations. That's documented in text messages, witness testimony. But nonetheless, we continue to chase down other leads, and these phone records provide other leads.
So you are still investigating that particular phone call. You said you couldn't confirm that it was the president's number. I understand that. But you are, that is, can you confirm that, that you are investigating that?
We certainly are investigating that. And look, Rudy Giuliani had only one client in the administration, and that was Donald Trump. So who is he talking to in the course of this smear campaign against Yovanovitch? Who is he talking to in the pursuit of these political investigations in Ukraine? There is certainly circumstantial evidence as to who those numbers might belong to in OMB. Obviously, Mick Mulvaney deeply involved in this scheme, but also the President of the United States.
What do we have here today? What is really interesting over today and for the next few weeks is America will see why most people don't go to law school. No offense to our professors. But please, really, we're bringing you in here today to testify on stuff that most of you have already written about, all four, for the opinions that we already know, out of the classrooms that maybe you're getting ready for finals in, to discuss things that you probably haven't even had a chance to say. Unless you're really good on TV of watching the hearings for the last couple of weeks, you couldn't have possibly actually digested the Adam Schiff report from yesterday or the Republican response in any real way. So we are here, no plan, no fact witnesses, simply being a rubber stamp for what we have. But hey, we got law professors here. What a start of a party.
Today, you're being asked to consider whether protecting those elections requires impeaching a president. That is an awesome responsibility. But everything I know about our Constitution and its values, and my review of the evidentiary record, and here, Mr. Collins, I would like to say to you, sir, that I read transcripts of every one of the witnesses who appeared in the live hearing, because I would not speak about these things without reviewing the facts. So I'm insulted by the suggestion that as a law professor, I don't care about those facts. But everything I read on those occasions tells me that when President Trump invited, indeed demanded foreign involvement in our upcoming election, he struck at the very heart of what makes this a republic to which we pledge allegiance. That demand, as Professor Feldman just explained, constituted an abuse of power.
Last month, the Department of Defense awarded a $10 billion cloud computing contract to Microsoft. Now, Amazon plans to protest the decision, claiming the deal was marred by errors and unmistakable bias. The contract, called Joint Enterprise Defense Infrastructure, or JEDI, provides the military with a cloud storage system for sensitive data. Amazon Web Services has been the company's leading profit driver for Amazon. Losing the deal could threaten its position as leader in the cloud industry. AWS had been considered the favorite to win the contract, but that changed after President Trump began to question the evaluation process. Trump has frequently criticized Amazon and its CEO, Jeff Bezos. An AWS spokesperson said it's critical for our country that the government and its elected leaders administer procurements objectively and in a manner that is free from political influence. Microsoft and the Department of Defense did not comment.